Look over the other announcements. We're still collecting the bottled water for the homeless, and let's now prepare our hearts to worship the Lord.
People of God, the psalmist says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth. Come before the Lord with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pastures. Enter into his courts with thanksgiving and with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name, for the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures throughout all generations. Let's stand together as we worship our God with song.
Thank you.
Almighty God, you are the creator of heaven and earth. We stand in awe at your boundless greatness and infinite majesty. You alone hold the power to sustain the universe. And in your wisdom, you have made everything that exists. You govern all things with perfect righteousness and inscrutable wisdom. We thank you with grateful hearts for the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ, our Savior, who redeemed us from sin and the curse of the law and brought us into the marvelous light of salvation. We are completely dependent upon your grace, for without your mercy, we have no hope at all. But in Christ, we have your promise of eternal life. As we lift our voices in worship, may we praise you in a way that is pleasing in your sight, and may you receive all honor and glory. Fill our hearts with reverence and joy as we offer our worship to you, O Lord. We pray in the strong name of Jesus. Amen.
Please turn to the book of Job for our Old Testament lesson, Job chapter 42, and we shall read verses 1 through 6. This is the recording of Job's repentance before the Lord, and it came in the aftermath or as a byproduct of his exposure to the truth. You may recall that God sat Job down, as it were, in chapters 38, 39, 40, and 41, and gave him an oral examination, the likes of which we would never want to be part of. And after the Lord had finished, this is Job's response. Then Job answered the Lord and said, "I know that you can do all things, and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. Hear, and I will speak. I will question you, and you make it known to me. I had heard of you by the hearing of the ear, but now my eye sees you. Therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes." Let us join Job as we come into the presence of God. We cannot help but be mindful of our unworthiness, and so let us cast ourselves upon the mercy of Almighty God. Together we pray. Our Father in heaven, we confess that we have sinned against you and are unworthy of your grace and favor. Too often we have forgotten your holiness, minimized our sinfulness, and disparaged your saving grace. We repent of our self-righteousness and plead for the imputed righteousness of Christ. For his sake, we beseech you to pardon our many sins, cleanse our hearts, save our souls, and grant us everlasting peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Heavenly Father, like Job, we've all suffered in some ways. And like Job, we've all thought that we suffered unfairly or unjustly. And like Job, we've been too sure of ourselves so often. And so, show us your glory, that we may see more of our unworthiness and therefore see more of your grace. So we know that where sin abounds, grace super abounds. We acknowledge you, O God, this morning. Though you are high and holy and inhabit eternity, we know that you also dwell with those who are of a lowly and contrite spirit. So revive us, we pray, and Bless us and make your face shine upon us and lift your countenance upon us that we may serve you faithfully and fearlessly, and that we may follow you and love you all of our days, and that we may make your way known on the earth and your saving power to all the nations. We worship you this morning as a God who over all things so wondrously reigneth. You are indeed our health and our salvation. And so we humbly ask that you heal Tim Cummings and Randy Campbell and Mike Bishop and Solana Taylor and Martha Vanderhaar and Charlie Smith and Don and Susan Birdwell and Janet Spann and Ron Hamilton and Debbie Kinney and Jean Ann Sumner. Encourage these with your grace and your goodness. And for those that are homebound, may your compassion rest upon them. Bless Joyce Davis and Elizabeth Rogers, Juanita Fentress and Don Dozier, Catherine Huddleston and Clarence Sutherland. We thank you so much, O Lord, for bringing the Collins and Young families to our staff and church. We ask you to bless and prosper their ministries, that our church may bear great fruit for your glory. We pray for your church around the world, that she will remain faithful to her first love, that she'll not be swayed by the winds of false doctrine, nor undermined by the shifting sands of cultural fads and trends. We pray for our upcoming conference to be a blessing to all. We pray for our nation to become again a nation under you, a nation you are eager to bless and prosper. So bless us with men and women in government who themselves are governed by your Spirit and will lead with truth and grace. As Job said, we know that you can do all things, that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Therefore, we ask you to comfort those who are in distress. How often in grief you have brought relief in the past. Please continue to do so. Please continue to make the woeful heart to sing of the fairest Lord Jesus. May your goodness and mercy daily attend those who need companionship. Spread your wings to overshade our children and grandchildren as they return to school. Awaken those who are spiritually dead within our family or circle of friends. And grant that all of us would hunger and thirst for righteousness. Forbid that any worldly success we enjoy by your grace would lead to pride and arrogance. Gently sustain and encourage those who spread the good news of Jesus Christ around the world. Hasten the day when all will be right in our hearts and in the world. When there'll be no more grief, suffering, war, conflict. When your enemies will be your footstool. When the nations that now rage and the people that now plot against you will be silenced. When your people will be sanctified and glorified. And on the earth there shall only be peace like a river and righteousness like the waves of the sea. For we ask this in the name of our blessed Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen. Beloved, the Lord hears our prayers and grants us the assurance that our prayers have been heard and our sins by his grace have been forgiven. We never want to minimize our sin. One of the great church fathers said that whoever has slight thoughts of sin has never had great thoughts of God. So the more we minimize our sin, the more we also minimize the gospel and the amazing grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. The psalmist says in Psalm 65, when iniquities prevail against me, you atone for our transgressions. The Lord Jesus Christ is faithful, and he's faultless, and he removes our sin as far as the east is from the west. R.C. Sproul once said that salvation is not God's reward for the righteous, but his gift to the guilty. We're all guilty, guilty as we can be. But the Lord has taken that guilt upon himself and imputed to us his righteousness. And so if you receive this, let all God's people say, amen, and let's stand and sing and celebrate. Please be seated. Love that energy. Great singing, great music. Thank you, choir. Thank you for being here. Please sign the attendance registration, if you don't mind. It's on the inside aisle here. Sign your name, pass it down the row, greet people after the service. And as you greet people after the service, what are you going to do? Take your hymnal. That's right. See, a lot of you had already forgotten. So take your hymnal, take two, take three if you can, and we'll put them on the tables in the narthex, and then we'll get set to rearranging the room for you to come right back here at 5 o'clock for a very wonderful time of celebration. Of course, 2 weekends from now, we look forward to our Holy Sexuality Conference, and I want to stress that reservations are required for the Saturday event. Not for Sunday school, not for Sunday worship, of course, but for the Saturday event, we do need you to go online and make a reservation. Christopher Ewan will be speaking to our youth and parents and having pizza at 5 o'clock. We get left out of that, I'm sorry. But if you're a youth and a parent of a youth, upstairs in the youth room, pizza, and you have the man to yourself. The rest of us will gather here at 6 o'clock for the beginning of the adult portion of the conference, I guess you'd say. So we look forward to that, and to talk about that this morning, someone I know very, very well, my wife Kristen, who would much rather sing to you than speak to you, but she's going to do the best she can. So here we are. You're going to do great. I know what she's going to say.
I don't know if the mic needs to be adjusted, does it?
Oh, I think you're fine.
We're good? Okay. Good. It's kind of in front of my words, but that's okay. Good morning. I am created in the image of God, the daughter of Paul and Millie Snyder. The DNA I inherited gave me my mother's blue eyes and smile, my daddy's curly hair, and both gave me the ability to sing. All of us are made in the image of God. As C.S. Lewis said, sons of Adam and daughters of Eve. Regrettably, our first parents sinned and passed on a sinful nature to us. Therefore, we need Jesus to save us from our sins. The foundational principle of our upcoming conference is that Jesus' redemptive work has set us free from the power of sin and given us the strength and capacity to live according to his word. Contrary to what we often hear, God does not shape our sexual preferences in ways contrary to his word. We choose either to obey biblical standards or sin against the holiness of God. Destructive forces now work overtime to normalize sin and desensitize the church. Individuals and organizations now strive to infiltrate, corrupt, and use once evangelical churches to endorse and advocate sexual sin. The leadership of North Point Church in Atlanta, a church of about 31,000 attendees, is a prime example of a church so influenced, as cited by Megan Basham in her recent book, Shepherds for Sale. Leading the charge to infiltrate churches are two men. First is John Stryker, gay heir to a $100 billion surgical supply conglomerate who launched the Arcus Foundation, whose stated purpose is to devote tens of millions of dollars to challenge narrow and hateful interpretations of religious doctrine within every major Christian denomination. This foundation has given over $2 million to the United Methodist Church and successfully secured the full participation of people of all sexual orientations in that denomination. The second man is Matthew Vines, founder of the Reformation Project. Don't be misled by that name. Vines' idea of reformation is to make, quote, the affirmation of homosexual unions a requirement of Christian faithfulness, end quote. The Bible and Stevens Valley Church and its leadership recognize these viewpoints as radically unbiblical. These perversions are nothing new, of course. For centuries, the Bible has told us the most loving thing to do is to stand for and speak the truth in love. Jude Ford tells us to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain people have crept in unnoticed who pervert the grace of God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Join us August 24th and 25th as we contend for biblical truth and our faith. We need to be well grounded in Scripture and equipped to speak the truth in love to those around us. I hope to see you there, and I'd like to remind you to turn your eyes upon Jesus. Thank you.
That was. Where'd she go? She disappeared. You want her to come back? We'll put her over there. She's a lot prettier than I am, isn't she? Again, welcome to our time of worship this morning. Let's now use our money the right way, and let's worship God with his tithe and our offerings.
Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that you are a faithful, covenant-keeping God. Over and over in the course of our lives, we have seen your faithfulness to us. Everything that we have needed, the Lord has provided. Bless these hands that have given of tithes and offerings today. Bless those who see the work of the kingdom of God as worthy of sacrifice and of giving, and pray that these gifts will go forth as you multiply them for the furtherance of your kingdom, that the gospel may be heard far and wide, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, it's my pleasure to be here with you to preach. Dina and I are here every 4 or 5 weeks, and we always love coming and seeing all of you and hearing Jim or someone else preach. So, again, a pleasure to be with you. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10. And we're going to begin reading at verse 5, and I'm going to stop at verse 16 instead of verse 23. Matthew chapter 10, beginning at verse 5. Hear now God's word. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and proclaim as you go, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. You received without paying, give without pay. Acquire no gold, nor silver, nor copper for your belts, no bag for your journey, nor two tunics, nor sandals, nor a staff, for the laborer deserves his food. In whatever town or village you enter, find out who is worthy in it, and stay there until you depart. As you enter the house, greet it. And if the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it's not worthy, let your peace return to you. And if anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, shake the dust off from your feet when you leave that house or town. Truly, I say to you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. Now, here's the key. Next verse. That's what we're going to talk about. Behold, I'm sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Amen and amen. May the Lord bless his word to our hearts this day. Just want to begin by saying something that you probably already realize, but the last command that Jesus gave before he ascended back up into glory into heaven was what we call the Great Commission. And he was telling us to be faithful, to be obedient, and part of that is teaching, and part of it is just speaking and being a witness. Well, that's not the only time he said to do that. And the text that we have before us here today is another one of those, where he told us not only to be a witness and endorse the truth, but to live it out. That's what verses 6 and 7 say. Go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, proclaim as you go, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now, not everybody, something I've learned later on in the ministry is the whole teaching of spiritual gifts. And I think the Reformed Church has missed that, certainly in my day. I think when we are regenerated by the Holy Spirit, we're given, and this is easy to find in Scripture, we're given at least one gift. Some of us are given two or three. Not everybody has the gift of evangelism. Not everybody has the gift of preaching or teaching. Not everybody has the gift of hospitality or administration. But here's the key. We're all called to fulfill the Great Commission in some way. But we're not all called to fulfill it in the same way. Very important if you think about that. And it will help you in your spiritual life. But what we're going to talk about today is being a little bit wiser about how you go about that. And I think in our culture today, and I'm going to expand that in just a minute, we're no less under the command to do this when Jesus gave it to the disciples as he ascended into heaven then. We're no less under the command than they were. He commanded them. It's still in effect today. Why is this important today? Unless you've been living in some world that I don't know about, you understand that the church has lost its influence greatly in America. It doesn't matter where you go. When I was growing up in Brandon, Mississippi, a suburb of Jackson, about 45% of the people were in church on Sunday, 45 to 50%. Now it's about 15%. That's the way it is here too. If you don't know that, just check me out, but that's the way it is. And so something has changed. And I think in a lot of ways it's, I'll go ahead and say what I really think. I think the seminaries haven't taught men like they should have. The church hasn't been the church. Whatever the issue is, folks, we got to get back in the game. There's no cutting class on this. It's time, and it's getting to be very scary. I believe in foreign missions, certainly, and promoted that all my life in the ministry, 50-something years. But the mission field has come right down the road. It's close by here. It's all over the world, but it's very close to where we are today. I want you to notice something. In the midst of these words of command from Jesus about going out and being witnesses and telling the truth, come some very wise counsels from Jesus about what to expect and how to be prepared when we do witness for him. And I want us to just take one of those counsels today. Verse 16. Jesus is saying we better wise up when we go out in his name, because there are wolves out there. And we need to remember that wolves like to eat sheep. And did you ever know that you in this room, we're the sheep? That's us. He's saying we better be understanding of the way the world works, or it will eat us up. Do you know what thoroughbred horses do when they are running in a herd and the herd is attacked? They circle together and kick out at whatever is attacking them and bothering them. Do you know what donkeys do when they're in a herd and they're attacked? Just the opposite. They circle together and put their faces out, and they kick in and hurt each other. So often Christians have been like donkeys. We only hear one side of an issue, and we jump to conclusions, and we're not paying attention to what Proverbs 18, verse 17 says. There are always two sides to everything. You need to pay attention and be a little bit wiser. It's crazy how we often have acted, and some of what's going on today is certainly our fault. Listen, we need to be crazy like a fox. We need to know something about our culture. We need to know something about politics and about business and about education and economics and every other field. And we need to know it better than the world knows it. We need to do our homework. We need to understand pagans, because Jesus said they're like wolves. And because our education system is so dismal in America today, you may not like me saying that, but it's the true truth. And even our private schools, and sometimes even our Christian schools, not all, they're not producing and turning out what we had turning out 50 years ago or 100 years ago. And so it's sad that the world is often better at these things and knows more about it than we do. I'll say some things now that'll be a little bit controversial. Which institution in culture today is the most corrupt? Is it education? My daughter Emily's not going to like this. Is it the legal profession? There's not a law school in America that teaches law about moral law. They all teach case law. Not completely, but that's a whole lot of the way lawyers are trained today. And you can see it in the decisions that are made by the courts everywhere. They're always looking back to something that's been done before. How about medicine? Dina and I just heard this morning about a couple of things in her family where it looks like there's been malpractice when it shouldn't have been at all. Oh, the banking industry isn't corrupt, is it? No. Oh, but let me get to the big dog, the media. Lying dominates the media. And if you can't see that, you just need to study it a little bit deeper and get more serious about listening. And I wish I had time to develop every one of those because I think I should. It wasn't always that way in our culture and in the Western world. I'm going to mention just a few things to prove my case. Take art, and by that I mean the arts. What is art today? It's bumper stickers sometimes that say, Jesus is my co-pilot. And little plaster molds of praying hands. Whatever, where are the artists today and the musicians today like Handel and Michelangelo and Johann Sebastian Bach and Felix Mendelssohn and Dürer? I know some of you in here have been to the National Gallery in London. I know some of you have been to the Louvre in Paris, and I've been to both of those. And the great preponderance of art there is Christian. You don't find that anymore. What about science? Christian accomplishments, or at least that we're told by that accomplishments in the field of science today, are almost virtually non-existent. That hadn't always been the way it is. Whatever happened to the accomplishments of someone like Sir Isaac Newton or Samuel Morse or Lord Kelvin? Dina did me a big favor last year at Christmas and gave me a book, the biography of James Clerk Maxwell. My guess is you don't know who that is. James Clerk Maxwell grew up in Scotland, out in the country. He was very intelligent. He got a good education. He was a real believer, always was. Kind of took a little heat for it from time to time, but never backed away from it. He became quite famous for his teaching at Cambridge. And he retired back to Scotland to be closest. He taught the catechism to the children in his church. So why is he so unusual? James Clerk Maxwell was a physicist and did a lot of research, was a brilliant, brilliant scientist, and never backed away from letting people know he was a Christian. Einstein said that Maxwell is the one that really taught him how to split the atom. That's one of us, folks. How about literature? Christian literature today is often a poorly worded tract handed out on a street corner or the Sunday school. There was a time when Christians were at the forefront of the literary world. You know that. John Donne? How about Paradise Lost? How many in this room have read Pilgrim's Progress? Raise your hand. See? Where's something like that today? I would have a difficult time even getting it printed. Sir Walter Raleigh, Florence Nightingale, Clara Barton. The list is long. When is the last time, let's get down to business here. When is the last time you know of or have met a deeply committed Christian who has genuine, true political savvy? There are a few in Washington. I honestly think Tennessee's doing better than just about any state I know. And what I'm talking about that is someone who has a biblical ethic and knows how to think biblically and brings that and applies it into the issue to the issues that are tearing us apart today. They may come out against it, but they rarely ever say, well, it's because we know that isn't what God wants, because they know they're going to be talked about and they're scared to say that because they want to get reelected. Let me give you a limerick. There once was a young lady from Niger who smiled as she rode off on a tiger. They came back from the ride with the lady inside, and now the smile was on the face of the tiger. I honestly think Jesus would have liked that. Let's look at what he's saying in the latter part of the scripture that I read, verse 16. He's saying, be wise. Why in the world would Jesus say, be wise as a snake? Because a serpent or a snake has to be wise because it lives in a world where it is hated. Most of you, like I, have always said, the only good snake is a dead snake. The first thing we normally try to do if we see a snake, and they often catch us by surprise because we didn't know they were looking at us, is try to kill it. And so the snake has instinctively become wary and wise. What does it do most of the time? Just two or three points. It stays away from trouble if it can. Jesus is saying, be wise, have some common sense, and common sense seems to be not very common. Be smart like a snake and avoid trouble. If you play with fire, you're going to get burned. Don't court quarreling and controversy. And I'm not saying don't stand up for things and don't just, you know, I'm not saying that at all. But be careful how you do it. Don't cast your pearls before swine. Be careful when you witness to someone. Witness, please. Don't be afraid to say it. Do it. But learn to be gentle. Don't come across harsh and angry. Sometimes it's better to have your mouth closed when silence is stronger than speech. I've learned this the hard way. I have the kind of personality that likes to get into it. And I've learned, and I'm still learning, that it's so much better to be careful. Don't think that you or I are any different from those people in the Bible who couldn't handle temptation. David, Solomon, Samuel, Peter, the list is long. They all succumbed. You will too, and I have too. Set a watch over your heart. That's what Proverbs says over and over again. Read the book of Proverbs. It just says it again and again, trying to get it across to us. Be careful. Get into it, but be careful how you do it. Be wise like a serpent, sly enough to avoid trouble. And when you see it, learn to keep your mouth closed. Number two, snakes move quietly. He doesn't observe observation. It moves gracefully. Quickly, I read an article a while ago. This will surprise you. Do you know how fast a black runner moves? You know, they're known for 4 miles an hour. Quietly. In other words, don't sink after publicity. There are times to ring the bell for help. There are times to ring the bell for rejoicing. But don't try to always be in the limelight. And there's some people who have a problem with this. Their egos are big, and they want everyone to see what they're doing. Oh, you ought to hear what's going on in my Sunday school class with these kids. Man, I'm getting through to them. Come see my zeal for the Lord. Or on the secular side, if you read the alumni magazine, sure, we'll give $10 million for that building if they put my name on the building or put my father's name on the building. Jesus said the better part of wisdom is to do your work regularly, faithfully, and quietly. Who you think's keeping records? He is. The Holy Spirit is. The records are being kept in heaven. And you will be rewarded for what you've done for His glory. He will reward you. When I was here back in, I think, May, I heard Jim use this story, and I'm not going to tell the whole thing, of course, because it's a wonderful story about the missionary who comes home in the early part of the century. He'd been in Africa about 40 years. Theodore Roosevelt was on the boat. Missionary was coming home. He'd been there 40 years and never been home. He thought there might be some people there to greet him there in New York in the harbor. They weren't there at all. The big band, big crowd. At first he thought they were for him, and then he realized they were for Theodore Roosevelt. Broke his heart. You remember telling that? And you know, the story goes, one version of it I read said he just heard something in his heart that said, son, you're not home yet. He was so disappointed. Another version says his wife told him the next morning. Either way, the point is well taken. About 4 years ago, I used that story in a sermon. There was a man in that, it's a little bitty church in Raymond, Mississippi. There was a man in that crowd, little crowd, whom King and Jim would remember. His name was Wallace Carr. He was professor, yeah, they're shaking, nodding their head. He was professor of counseling at Reformed Seminary. I had him too. He wasn't that great a teacher. And everybody through the years has always said didn't learn much from him. And he didn't get much acclaim. Okay, that morning I used that story. He's 92, sitting out there, and I used that story. And when I had the closing prayer and the benediction, I looked up, And right beside me was this man, Wallace Carr, 92 years old. He'd made it up to the pulpit and got, well, I mean, he was this close to me. And I looked at him, and tears were just coming out of his eyes. And he said, "I've never heard anything like that. I'm close to getting home." And he died a month later. What else does a snake do? Goes where others don't go. Surprisingly, snakes turn up at the oddest places. She won't want me to say this. All I'm just going to make in a quick reference. Ask Dina what she did when a snake turned up in her dryer vent. Here's the point. If we can't get into someone's heart one way, we ought to try another. If a person won't come to church, won't come to this church with you, give them a little book or give them a tape of Jim preaching or somebody else preaching and say, "You need to listen to this. Do me a favor and listen to this." And all the time you're doing it, be gentle and loving and compassionate. There's a way into everybody's heart. If you know how to find it, find it. Be wise as a serpent and discover it. Keep thinking, keep praying. Even a big old gigantic whale has a tough skin, and you can hit it with a spear. That whale with a spear won't make a difference at all. But did you know under every whale's body at the bottom there is a soft, tender spot where that whale can be brought to death? The most ungodly, wicked, blaspheming, arrogant, profane persons in Williamson County or Davidson County has some point where you can get next to them if you can but find it. And Jesus says, be wise as a serpent. Keep trying. Don't give up. Someone has said, and I love this, we need to love people and keep loving them until they ask us why. And quickly end up being innocent. The other side of all that I've been saying here today is we need to be innocent, be harmless. If we're going to traffic it, if we're going to deal with pagans, and folks, we got to do it. We got to get this thing back. We cannot lose it in our time. If we're going to traffic with pagans, we need to be good at being a good witness and being innocent and harmless also. What is a dove doesn't have any horns, does it? A dove has no weapon. Not a horn, not a hoof, not a fang. He's defenseless. And Jesus is saying the way a dove operates just makes him very, very strong. He's saying, be crafty like a snake and be innocent like a dove. I will read you what Charles Spurgeon said about this very text. You are to be gentle and easily entreated. You're not to fly into a passion because you are contradicted, nor to be angry because you are reviled. You are to endure contradiction and slander with tenderness. It's so hard for somebody like me to do. When I hear them make a mistake, I want to fire back at them and say, "You jughead, you don't know what you're talking about." I wouldn't say that. I wouldn't say that. But I think it. So do you never be driven to sinful word or deed, but do good to all men and glorify God in all things by being gentle and pure as a dove. Let your strength and your wisdom lie in your artless truthfulness and childlike dependence upon God. See how Christ explains his own utterance, a further little word, and I didn't read it. Harmless as doves, when they deliver you, take no thought how or what you're going to say. Be like a dove, confident, gentle, artless, simple, and restful. Okay, let me ask you a few questions and through. A lot of you in this room are as old as I am, 78. How wise are you? How mature are you? I've met people in their 70s and 80s that I don't think are matured in anything and learned anything at all in life. So, do you often argue? Do you always have to answer back and have something extra to say? Let me tell you about the meek grandmother in the church where I knew about. She had a son who married a woman, and this girl that the man, her son, married was just cocky and arrogant and always wouldn't listen to anything, always had a better answer, and it just got worse and worse. And then they had children, and it was worse and worse. And the grandmother said she just wanted to say, "Get out of here! I'm sick of listening to you." But she never did it. All she did, it was, she wanted to, but all she did was pray. "Please, Lord, give me an opening with this girl." And about 10 years into the marriage, the woman came to her one day and said, "I don't know what you've got, but whatever it is, I want it. Because you just know so much and you are so wise. What am I missing?" And the grandmother said, "I don't think you're a Christian. And I want to talk to you about it." And she led her to Christ. And she became a very faithful member. And thanks to listening to her mother-in-law's advice, became a very godly mother and grandmother eventually. Do you stay after the people? I've already said this, but do you give up and say, "Well, I've asked somebody in my family, I prayed for them for so long, I prayed for my mother, I prayed for my father, I prayed for my brother, I prayed for somebody at work, pray for somebody in the neighborhood, I've just done it now, nothing's happening," give up. No. Everybody in this room today is benefiting from what a mother prayed about with her son. Her name was Monica, and she had a son named Augustine. Augustine was about as wild as you can be. And just whatever you want to think a 25, 26-year-old young man can do in Carthage, North Africa, he did it quite a bit. Monica was a serious Christian, and she was brokenhearted with her son, but she prayed every day over and over and over, "Lord, please save Augustine." They moved to Italy, and Augustine began to hang out with a man named Ambrose, who was kind of the bishop there. And one day he was in the garden with Ambrose, and there were some copies of some of the scripture. This was in about the 4th century. And he looked, and it was a verse, I won't read it to you, but you can look it up, Romans 13:13-14. "Take up and read." And it was about the gospel. And Augustine, shortly thereafter, Ambrose led him to Christ. Augustine shaped so much of Christianity through the centuries with his writings. Brilliant. He became a bishop, and he had huge influence and still has it today. Augustine's teachings have shaped the church for centuries. Monica died about a year or two after Augustine was converted. There's a funny story about it. I'll tell you, after he was converted, he was walking in the streets of Carthage one day, and he was walking down the street. They hadn't moved to Italy yet. He was still in his late 20s. And one of the girls with whom he had been friends, I'll say, saw him walking, and she yelled out to him, and she said, "Augustine! Augustine!" And he kind of glanced up, but he just put his head down and kept walking, and she said, "Augustine, it is I." And Augustine said, "Yeah, but it's not I anymore." The Lord had regenerated him, changed him. It made Monica so happy. You think about that story. There are people that everybody in this room knows they'd like to see come to know Christ. In your neighborhood, in your family, in your office, in your business somewhere. Don't give up. The Holy Spirit can do it. Keep praying. And very quickly, how innocent are you? I've already talked about it. Do you always have to have the last word? Do you always have to have a word of contradiction? Just tell the truth. Gently, but firmly, and stand by it. So the final question is, the Bible tells us to be imitators of Christ. There were times when he got pretty serious, didn't he? There were times when he didn't back down. But there are also times when he was so loving and kind and gentle. And I think Ephesians 5, 1 and 2 tells us to be imitators of Christ. I want you to think about that as you come to the table today. Lord, I need to get better so I can get back in the game. Maybe you're in it. But maybe you need to be encouraged a bit. Let that encourage you to be an imitator of Christ. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for true truths. I don't know that I'm the best to present them, but your word's there, infallible, right. May the Holy Spirit take what's been said, if it has been true truth, and pierce our hearts and make us concerned about our culture, about the church in our day, and may we speak your words with the power of the Holy Spirit. May we live out, may whatever gift we have, may we use it for your glory and honor. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
So here set before us are the signs and seal of the covenant of grace, the broken body and the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Here's the question. If you come to the Lord's table today, what does it mean for you that Jesus' body was broken? What does it mean for you that his blood was shed? May I propose to you that the only right answer to that question is absolutely everything. Absolutely everything. There's nothing more important than to know Jesus Christ by faith. There's nothing greater than that. And so if you know the Lord Jesus Christ by faith today, if you're his child, then these elements are for you. And to take them and to know, taste and see that the Lord is good. But if you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, then the scriptures warn not to partake of these elements because we invite the chastening and judgment of God. So we would like to ask you, if you're here and you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, then please don't leave without asking one of us how you can know him or what we can do to help and support you in knowing him. Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." He also took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. For as often as you drink it, you show forth the Lord's death until he comes." So as often as we eat this bread, drink this cup, we show the Lord's death until he returns. He will return, and we will feast with him on that day. And we need to be ready for that by trusting in him day by day. Taste and see that the Lord is good.
Thank you.
Before I announce the last hymn, I want to take about 30 seconds to mention something about this hymn. I get to preach in a lot of places, and in this past year, I've just taken it upon myself to have a personal crusade to teach a hymn to people that they don't know. This hymn is, I want this hymn sung at my funeral. It was written by Samuel Rutherford. If you don't know that, a great, great Scottish man, preacher. He was at the Westminster Assembly, one of the members of the Westminster Assembly. Charles Spurgeon said, there's a little book you can get called The Letters of Samuel Rutherford. It's been reprinted 50 times. Spurgeon read it and said, it is the closest thing to real scripture I've ever read. He wrote this hymn, and you'll never sing one with better words than this. We're only going to sing the first and last stanzas. Let's rise and sing it together. Now receive God's benediction. Now may the electing grace of God the Father, the redeeming grace of God the Son, and the communing and sanctifying grace of God the Holy Spirit descend in your hearts and minds and remain with you always, both now and forevermore, world without end. May you go in His peace this day if you love Jesus Christ in sincerity. Amen. Amen.